Eons have passed since the day humans emerged on the face of the Earth. Colonies erected all over the galaxy, breathing new life to a society of Homo sapiens. Life was flourishing on rocks that were once empty and barren. Until one day, the colonies were visited by an ancient being, the Barong, creator of life, architect of the humans, bearing grave news about the death of planet Earth. Stories of a great war ignited by the evil deity Rangda, annihilating every life form on Earth, placing a curse on the terrestrial sphere we once called home. Seeking help from the humans, Barong assembled a group composed of Colony Number 200's bravest and brightest minds. Only enlightened with information of two living beings left on Earth, half-Barong humans known as demigods, the adventurers traveled back to their homeland Earth to uncover the dark secrets and uplift the curse that was left behind by the evil Rangda. Chapter 1, Yellowclaw and Weewick, the first three. The first humans to make the risky descent to planet Earth were Yellowclaw, well known for their survival techniques on Colony Number 200. Trained by the elites in the military force, and Weewick, one of the brightest minds the galaxy has to offer, ready to study every speck that planet Earth throws at them. Hastily saying goodbye to the rest of the crew, they make their way to the armory and arm themselves the best they can. While fueling their jetpacks, they gaze up into the galaxy, thinking about what lies ahead of them. Longtime friends, Weewick and Yellowclaw never needed to exchange many words. When it's time for action, their minds synchronize like a flawless harmony. As they drew closer and closer to Earth, they wondered, how could this be the Earth they once studied in their science books? Chapter 2. Was this home? A couple days later, the rest of the group from Colony 200 landed their transport ships onto the sandy hills of what Earth called Nevada. The planet, once flourishing with life, is now a desolate rock, floating in space, deprived of life. Resembling what once seemed like a thriving civilization, is now covered in artifacts of a great war. Not knowing where to start searching for the two demigods, desperately trying to make contact with anyone that might still be alive, they were only greeted with silence. Remnants of death were scattered all over the land, swords and armors left by the people who would not give up on hope on their home. In the midst of all the destruction lies a helmet that resembles nothing of an earthly origin. "This might be our first clue," one of them proclaimed. But was a mere helmet enough to guide them towards the right path? Chapter 3. Nonsense, Explorers of the North. After months of searching far and wide, all members of the fleet were growing weary, losing hope on finding the two demigods the Barong spoke of. Nonsense, ex-military scientists, professionals at navigating icy tundras, traveled northwest to an empty frozen land in hopes to find the two demigods left to suffer by the evil Rangda. There they searched far and wide to only come across an abandoned science outpost where they found several clues, research papers left behind by scientists before their demise. "It seems like these scientists had a reasonable understanding of where they could find the last two people," proclaimed Rasmus. "These documents also show some evidence that Rangda would perish without the life force of the humans on Earth they feed off," he continued. After studying through most of it, the team finally found what they needed to continue their journey. Chapter 4, Psycho Boys Club, into the wild. After wandering the sandy and stony flatlands for days, both men see signs of what appears to be a more lively part of Earth. Not soon after, they found themselves on the outskirts of a forest, overgrown with giant mushrooms and trees, but no life to be found. They enter with caution and make their way deeper in hopes of discovering any signs of the two demigods. The forest welcomes them at first, but soon, as they couldn't find their way back, even if they wanted to, their feelings shift to one of unease. The feeling that they are being watched, followed even. Although they feel the presence, they cannot see these creatures, almost as if floating around them like spirits, trying to lead them in the wrong direction. "Ignore them," Stoltenhoff whispers. "Deep down, you know that everything they say isn't true. They are trying to confuse us." Julian wipes his sweaty forehead and replies, "That probably means we're getting close." Chapter 5, Crisis Era, Seekers of Truths. After the Discovery Team located Psycho Boys Club, everyone regrouped to do a final trek up the steep mountains. Months of searching and discovery, the team can finally see an end to their journey. Climbing up the final rocky slopes of the mountain, the group sees a fleet of Rangda's ship ready to take off. "We are fucked. They're going for our mothership orbiting around Earth. We're going to be stuck here," Matt says. And from the back of the group, a Russian man says, "Bit, I'll take care of this. I need to get home to my babushka." Ghoster, the lone warrior, known for his gunmanship, rushes back to the transport, where he launches himself into orbit, more than ready to blast each and everyone into tiny pieces. Chapter 6, Ghoster, the Lone Warrior. As soon as he penetrated the atmosphere into space, he was met with Rangda's space armada, consisting of 5 warships. Alone in a travel ship, not equipped with any weapons, Ghoster, pumped with adrenaline, puts on his oxygen mask and flings himself out of the ship towards his enemies. Every shot Rangda's ship shot at him all misses, as he flung around space, jumping from one satellite to another, like a crazed Russian ninja. Eliminating one ship at a time with a mere plasma pistol, and of course, his taste for destruction. "This is for planet Earth!" With his final blast of plasma, he eradicated the fleet and contacted his team back on Earth. "Are you guys finished or what? I want to go home, so hurry this shit up and somebody come get me. It's kind of cold up here." Chapter 7, The Lifted Curse. Alas, with everyone trying to figure out how to get Ghoster out of the vacuum of space, Jim and Nils travel deep into the cave that was guarded by the Rangda fleet. Inside, they walk through tiny crevices, barely fitting through.
"It seems like those Rangda soldiers have been camping here for a while now. Perhaps protecting something important,"
Jim says. With a final squeeze through some narrow-looking pathway, they were greeted with a gigantic opening in the cave, where a big stone head laid against the cave wall.
"That must be it!"
As the boys rush towards the stone head frantically, looking for clues on what to do with it. Hours pass with no luck on opening the stone head, until Nils notices the stone eyes would glow ever so slightly when the Barong helmet they found was brought near the head.
"That's it! This helmet must have been worn by a Barong warrior wielding mystical powers."
Nils puts on the helmet and a sudden rush of energy enters his body. Glowing with a bright red aura, Nils now wields the power of the Barong. His body trembling with frightening energy,
not knowing where to direct this force. He looks at Jim for answers. Jim yells out, "Punch the stone! They must be inside it!" Without hesitation, Nils clenches his fists and destroys the stone head. A combustion of sizzling flames erupts from within, and the stone head explodes. For a moment, the cave seems like it's going to collapse on them. Just when they think their lives are over, being crushed by the cave and failing the Barong. Chapter 8. Soda and Ray Ray, the slumbering demigods. Inside, they found the two demigods, and they are surrounded by a bright, magical flame, feeding off their life force, keeping the curse alive. Trapped by cursed flames, ignited by Rangda, Ray Ray and Soda wake up from a shallow sleep, filled with nightmares, and witness their saviors. The colony combines their powers and uplift the curse cast on the two women. As the flames die out, and the two warriors take back their consciousness, the curse placed down on the earth is finally lifted, draining the life force Rangda needed to stay alive. The heroes sit down for the first time in weeks, pleased and proud of what they have achieved as a group. And although someone could easily mistake this for an ending, they all knew this was just the beginning.